welcome back to the channel. On today's video, I'm going to be working on the coil box and coils in the Model T. I have to rebuild the coil box and work on the coils themselves as well. So very interesting stuff getting the ignition system ready to go on this car.
Here are my original Model T coils that came with the car. And these are for the 2607 model. They went through several different stages of upgrading on the coils, different makes of coils. Ford made his own coils for the majority of it. The real early cars, I think they had some different makes and different suppliers for the coils, and then Ford started making its own. And so these are Ford coils from the last 2 years, and you can tell what years they're made by the ways they're stamped. The last couple years, they stamped Ford at the top along the coil here. I forget all the different rules of figuring them out, but you can figure them out by looking at them. Some of the Ford coils were stamped in the middle of the wood, some on the sides. I know the last couple years I stamped them at the top. So you can tell by where they're stamped what years they were made. I think the bridges on the top, the contacts and stuff on the top, that changed a little bit over the years. But in theory, they all work the same. They're just changed a little bit. They have three contacts on them, two on the side and one on the bottom. The bottom is the power coming in, the top one is for the timer, and the bottom one is a spark plug. So when the timer contacts hit in the timer, they trigger the top contact, which triggers a coil to spark on the lower contact. So real cool, when they spark, they buzz. That's what this, they're called trembler coils a lot because they buzz. And this top piece right here is on a little hinge with the contacts. And that buzzes, it makes a real fast vibrating sound. That's why they're called trembler coils. Anyway, they work really well, and most people run original coils. You can get remade, but originals are in vast supply. The one thing that goes bad is the condenser or the capacitor. Same thing, they call them condensers or capacitors. It is basically an original capacitor. This is the one that I pulled out of this coil when I put in the new one. And originally they were made something like aluminum foil, some sort of metal foil, wrapped with a treated paper for the dielectric in between. So the treated paper and then the aluminum foil and then I think another piece of paper were all laid out and then rolled up in this little roll and then a strip placed on each side for the power to it. So it's basically just a rolled up parallel plate capacitor. And it worked originally quite well. And the boxes are sealed quite well. That's what all this tar is. This black stuff is tar, and it was poured in to seal everything, keep it from rattling around, and seal out moisture. Because as you can imagine, moisture and paper don't get along so well. So the original capacitors worked well for a long time, but now it's been anywhere between 180 and 100 years later, the moisture has worked its way into these boxes, gotten into the paper, and can short out these capacitors, and they just wear out because of their construction. So very few original capacitors are good anymore. It's hard to find an original one that is good or will last. It will go out eventually. So very good to replace them. When I took my coils in to have them tested, two of them had good spark, one had a mediocre spark, and the other one didn't work. So I'm just going to replace all of the capacitors in them. So when you take apart the coil, or the box here, you have the back side of the box has two brads at the bottom. You pull out those nails, this piece slides out, and then you have the tar. Here are your primary windings, and you do not want to mess with those. If you dig into that tar at all, you can ruin the primary windings and pretty much ruin the coil. Now on this side is where the capacitor is. So you have to chip out the tar just on this side, and that's what I've done with this one in the center here. You chip out the tar on that side, and then you can access the capacitor that lays in here. And then there's a piece of glass that's right next to the capacitor. So the tan-looking piece is the capacitor. And then there's a thick piece of glass that separates it from the rest of the coil parts. So you just want to chip on top of the glass and to the left. You don't want to get anywhere to the right because then you can get into the windings. And if you nick the windings, then they short out and the whole coil doesn't work and you have to start over. Hard to fix. From my research and experience, it seems the best way is to chip out the tar if you're just replacing the condenser and not doing anything else in the box. Some people do try and melt this out. I feel like that would be a huge mess. It's not that hard to chip it out. You just use a small screwdriver, and most of it comes out in chunks. Now, it depends on the year of the car. The earlier cars, I think they come out in a little bit better chunks because the tar is a little bit different. The later cars, the 26 and 7, the coil box is in the engine compartment, and you don't want a soft tar in that because it can get a little bit warm and the tar melt through. So if you use a real early coil in a late car, the tar can melt through. If you use the wrong type of tar, it'll melt out of the coil and make a huge mess. So they use, I believe it was called type 3 tar, and it has a higher melting point, so it won't melt being in the engine compartment. So you chip all the tar out just on top of the capacitor, pull the capacitor out, and then solder in a new one. And the new capacitors are a good deal smaller. Manufacturing has changed a lot since then, especially with electrical components. So this capacitor does exactly the same thing as this, exactly the same ratings. I forget the exact numbers. I remember 0.47 microfarads, 400 volts, and there's a couple other characteristics too. It has to be just the right capacitor or it won't work. But pretty standard capacitor size, nothing extravagant. But that little red capacitor replaces this in the original. It does the exact same thing, exactly the same characteristics. So pretty cool. Electronics have come a lot way since then. But basically you just have to solder it in between the two wires. So on the original capacitor, you have this long wire that goes to this top contact post, comes down and hits the bottom of the capacitor, and then goes somewhere down into the windings. I don't know where this wire goes. I could look up a diagram, or I have one. I'd have to look and see where that goes. But basically, you have to put the capacitor between this wire and the top wire right here. And so you can just barely see it right there, that wire. That is a top face of the original capacitor, and that goes to these top contacts right here, these two contacts. So sometimes you will occasionally see someone put a capacitor on the outside between these two contact posts, and that works. It doesn't look good, and it doesn't work the greatest, but it does work. If the original capacitor is shorted out, they'll sometimes do that, and it's easier than digging into it. But I want it to look right, so I'm actually going to do it correctly. So you just have to solder it in between the top wire and the bottom wire of the original capacitor, and so that means these two wires here, so I just did it for ease like this. And that's pretty much it. You just have to solder those two connections and then put it back together. And from my research, it seems that the best practice is to put the original tar back in. Some people have tried using silicone and stuff. I guess it eats the wires a little bit. The acid and the silicone can ruin your wires over a long period of time. Definitely the safest approach is just to put the tar back in. So most people will melt your pile of tar and pour it back in. And because you took out this big piece, you have to cut a board to fit. You get some scrap boards, pieces of wood to stuff in there so you don't have to pour a ton of tar in. Fill it up as much as you can with wood and then just sort of glue it together with tar. The purpose of the tar is to seal moisture out and to just keep everything from rattling and keep it secure so it won't come apart. So I will probably put some pieces of wood in here, tuck this capacitor down in the side, and then pour some tar back in just to glue it back together. These capacitors are much smaller than they have in the past. If you look at online posts and stuff, you'll find that most people have to take out the glass piece. The new capacitors, you don't. I forget what style they used before, but they were round tubes, and the diameter was a bit too large. It wouldn't fit in the glass, so you had to take the glass piece out. With these new flat-style capacitors, you don't have to take out the piece of glass because they are really thin. So it'll be real easy just to kind of slide it down in there and then pour tar back over it to glue it together. So not real difficult. So I'm going to solder this back together on all of these, and then I'll probably put the backs on and take them back in to Antique Auto Ranch, get them tested first and adjusted before I pour the tar back in case something is wrong or doesn't work and I have to redo something. I don't want to have to redo the tar again as well. So I want to make sure they all work before I repot them. But that's pretty much it. Not terribly hard, definitely doable. If they do need work, there's a lot of people who rebuild them completely, redo all the tar, check everything, and make them run really well. And the prices range around $300 for a set of four, something like that. And if you want a really good spark, trouble-free, that seems to be a really good route to go. And they'll put new contacts on and stuff too. I'm just going to clean mine, run a little bit of 400 grit sandpaper in the contacts there, because they do, when we tested them, they're pretty hot the way they were. So I think if we just clean up the contacts a little bit, they'll work the way they are for now. I am ready to repot these coils with tar, but as you notice from the lighting situation, the power went out last night in a really strong windstorm, and it's still pretty gusty and cold outside, so I can't open the garage door if I don't want to be freezing cold. So I am down to the lantern. It doesn't allow much light, but it is fun to see that this is as much light as people worked with back in the day. These things do not put out much, so you were really tied to daylight schedules back then. Pretty interesting. You can just see there's just a little bit of light, but it's not real bright at all. I'm working mostly off that, and then I have a flashlight for when I need a little bit extra light, but that lantern does not put out very much light. So I'm ready to repot these with tar, and I have put the new capacitors in. You might notice I have 5 coils instead of 4. One of my coils was bad, and it can be fixed. It's going to be a bit of a pain to fix, but I will do it eventually. The primary windings, those are these two rolls right here. They are okay, but there's some other wire in here that's broken that is buried in tar. Somewhere up here in the top, I can't find it without digging, and it's going to be a pain to dig around those windings because you don't want to nick the windings with your screwdriver when you're digging in the tar. So I am probably going to take a heat gun and melt this out when I redo it, because you don't want to chip into the windings. So it's going to be a bit of a mess to fix it. And I actually happen to have another coil that was good, so I'm not going to be working on this one right now, but I'll have it as a spare if another one goes bad. This coil right here, though, is a coil my grandpa gave to me. He was using it for an electric fence, I believe, and it's actually a decent coil. It works. So I will be reusing that. I just put a new capacitor in it, and it mates up with all the others just fine, and I will fix that one later. It is kind of funny, though. I was reading about people using coils for things other than Model Ts. A lot of farmers used them for things like electric fences. And that's what my grandpa used this one for. So that's kind of cool. I was able to use his coil in my car. So I put the capacitors in all of them. I then just put a few pieces of wood in there to take up some of the space left behind by the old capacitor, because the new ones are so much smaller. And then I'm going to be remelting the tar. So I put the tar in this tin can, and I'm going to remelt it and pour it in the little space where the capacitors are. This one I couldn't get the old capacitor out, so I put it in here. There's a little bit of divot in the tar here. I was able to fit it down in there, and the lid will close with it the way it is. I think it is best to get the old capacitor out if you can, but this one just would not come. It was tearing it apart and not pulling out. It is better if you can to take the sideboards off of the boxes. None of the original ones of mine would come off. The one from Grandpa did, though. That's this sideboard right here. You can pry that off. But mine, the wood was just way too tight. It was going to crack the board before it pulled off. So I wasn't able to do it that way. If you can do it that way, though, it's way easier to get this capacitor out. And this one, I just could not get the board off, and I couldn't dig it out. So it's going to stay there for now. But with these new super small capacitors, you can make them fit without taking that out. Now I'm ready to melt the tar. So I have it in this little tin can, and I'm going to melt it on the good old wood cook stove. I have the fire going over here, and with the wood cook stove, this side of it is just about the perfect temperature. I have a little heat gun here, and if you measure that side of it, right now it's saying it's at 220 degrees, whereas the hot side over here by the fire is at 500 degrees plus. This gun won't measure over 500 degrees. So very hot on this side, about 250 or so degrees over here. So perfect for melting tar, because you don't want to get that tar real hot. Once it starts smoking, it is too hot, and you'll risk it flashing and boiling over, and that's real bad. Once you get it over too hot, it starts smoking, and the tar can catch fire and be a big mess. So this will work really well. I'll just leave it on this side of the stove and let it slowly melt. Might hit the can with a torch a little bit to speed it up. But it'll just stay warm over there and can't boil over or get too hot on it. And then I'll just use a pair of pliers and grab the can and pour it into the coils. So that should be all I need to do to get these coils up and running. I have taken them into Antique Auto Ranch and got them tested on the spark machine, and they got the gaps adjusted so they all draw the right amounts of amps. And now that'll work. I just have to put the tar in them and nail the backs back on, and they'll be ready to go. This is the coil box that came on my car. I have cleaned it up and painted it. And this is what houses the four ignition coils. So the four ignition coils are stacked in here, and they're what provides spark to the spark plugs. Because the Model T doesn't have a distributor, it has one coil per cylinder that are each fired by the timer. So when the timer contacts hit, the timer wires connect to the terminals on the front, and then that tells the plugs to, or the coils to fire, and the coils fire the plugs. So there's one coil for every cylinder, which is kind of cool. They did that back then. Shortly after the Model T, they switched to doing one coil with a distributor system, and now they're back to one coil per cylinder again with the modern coil packs. Kind of cool that they started out that way to begin with. Anyway, on the 26 and 7 cars, this box is mounted on the engine. So that's what I have. This is mounted on the engine. Earlier cars, this would have been mounted inside the cowl or on the floorboards or in different positions inside the cab, depending on the year. But for the 26 and 7, it was mounted in the engine compartment. It reduced the buzzing noise from the coils inside of the cabin when they were moved to the engine bay. It kind of made for a little bit quieter ride. Not by much, but it did quiet it up a little bit. So I have cleaned this up and painted it, and I took the wood out. The wood was pretty bad. That's what this piece is here, and this piece. So these are the two wood blocks. So you get the one on the bottom, and then one that goes on the side. And this one, when I took it apart, is completely unglued. So this one goes like this on the front of the box right here, and then this piece goes on the bottom of the box. So these provide the contacts to the coils. The coils have one contact on the bottom. This is the wire coming from the dash, from the switch, that provides power to the coils. And then on here, the bottom contacts are for the spark plugs, and the top contacts are the wires coming in from the timer. So I took these apart, and I took the old contacts off, and they were in really rough shape. These wires are supposed to be copper plated. The copper plating's all gone. The copper plating on the contacts are gone. Really rough shape, not gonna make a good electrical connection. The wood is in rough shape. It was cracked, and as you can see, completely unglued on the front plate here. When they made this, they have one piece of wood on the inside with the piece glued on each side on the edges. You have the front piece, and then on the inside, each one of these slats is glued on to provide the channels for the contacts to fit in. So the wood is generally advisable to replace, because if you ever get caught in the rain or it gets wet, it will soak up the water and it could short out your contacts and kill the engine. You won't be able to run until you get the wood dried out. So not good. You have to have the wood really well sealed so it won't soak up any moisture. There are kits available to replace these with plastic pieces if you plan on doing a lot of driving in the rain or don't want the hassle. I'm not going to do that, but it is an option. And a lot of people, they're painted black. You can't really tell it is plastic. And they'd say they do a good job of sealing up the box, much better than the original wood did. Now, I decided to do new wood because I like the wood and want to keep it original. And the kits, they were like $30 for the wood. Not too bad, but I had the tools, so I did my own wood work. And this is what I came up with. I decided to stain it and varnish instead of paint because I think it looks pretty cool. I'm going for original, but nice looking. So this is still original to have wood, but originally they would not have painted it. I decided to varnish it because it's a shame to cover up nice wood. And it kind of points out that this is wood. And that's one of the major cool parts about the Model T is how much wood was used in its construction. So that's why I stained the wheels and why I stained this piece to kind of highlight that there is wood in the engine compartment of the Model T. And then the rails are the original rails off of the original coil box. I pulled those off. They sat right here because they were in good condition. So I pulled them off and painted them and tacked them on here. So I think it looks kind of cool. This piece will go in the box, and there will be one more black band where this piece is. So I think that'll look pretty cool. It's just a little bit of wood stained pretty darkly. I'm not going to stand out too much, but you will be able to tell it is wood, and that was kind of my goal for this. So I cut these out, and I routed out the joints for the contacts. Not the greatest job, a bit sloppy, but it will suffice. You can't see the inside. It will make contacts, and that's all that matters. The bottom board, same thing, stained. There's one slit down the middle
for the bottom contacts, and then I riveted them. There's two rivets, and then the third one is a bolt that the wire from the switch bolts to underneath. So that gets a bolt and nuts, and the other two are riveted on. So I just got to put that bolt in, and then I have all new contacts for the front plate as well. Copper plated contacts with new bolts and new nuts. So I will put all those in and put the box back together and put it in the car.
Is completed on the Model T. I just have a few more things to wrap up, and this engine will be ready to start. So I'm hoping to be able to get this car running here real soon. So stay tuned for that update. As always, if you enjoyed this video, please subscribe to my channel, hit the like button on this video, or leave me a comment if you have any questions or concerns. Thank you for watching.